Yeah, we've been inundated by gluten recently, and we have these pseudoscience books, Grain Brain and Wheat Belly, and everyone's been getting into the gluten-free fad. We regard gluten-related disorders as basically three sets of conditions. One's the autoimmune condition of celiac disease that we'll mainly talk about. Wheat allergy is pretty common. About 15 to 20% of people going to baking school get allergic rhinitis or asthma. Wheat as a food allergy is common and in children, and they grow out of it. And then we're going to talk a little bit about this non-celiac gluten sensitivity. And certainly the general public and the food industry have run away with this concept of gluten-free, of gluten being bad for you, and it's really left the medical community behind. We'd last have some knowledge of what the prevalence of celiac disease is within the United States. Everyone's aware of the NHANES, the National Health and Nutrition Examination Survey. That involves about 5,000 Americans each year. Now, about 6 or 7 years ago, they asked the question, do you have doctor-diagnosed celiac disease, or are you on a gluten-free diet? And Joe Murray and collaborators tested about 10,000 serum samples. And overall, the data was extrapolated to the US population, and it's considered that 0.7% of the population have celiac disease. Amongst white people, it's 1%. So that's where we get the figure about 1% of whites in the United States have celiac disease. But what was quite shocking, really, was only 17% of those with celiac disease were aware that they had the condition. And that varies around the world. The highest rate of diagnosis is in Finland, where 70% of the 1% are diagnosed. And other developed countries are doing much better than the United States. Now, this 1% or 0.7% represents quite a dramatic increase. Now, this is another study done by Joe Murray and his colleagues, in which in the yellow box we have serum that was drawn 50 years ago. This is the Warren Air Force Base cohort, and it was basically 20-year-old white men going into the Korean War. And when that was analyzed, the serum has been maintained very well, been used in about three other studies. 0.2% had positive TTG and endomysial antibody. And then the cohorts taken now, which is 70-year-old white men or 20-year-old white men, it's about 1%. So celiac disease, as manifested by a single estimation of TTG and endomysial antibody, has increased 4 to 5-fold over 50 years. And that's in parallel to other autoimmune conditions. Now, we evolved to eat meat. Our digestive enzymes fully chop up meat protein into single amino acids, dimers, and trimers. But wheat was only introduced and grains were domesticated about 10 to 11,000 years ago. And then they spread laterally out of the Fertile Crescent. And so we didn't evolve to eat this protein that's very rich in prolines, and our endopeptidases don't chop it up into these small single amino acids, dimers and trimers. Instead, we're left with these large 33 amino acid long molecules that get into the lamina propria under various conditions, where tissue transglutaminase deamidates it and then allows its presentation to T cells. Now, what are the factors that allow for an individual to get celiac disease? Well, first of all, you've got to be eating gluten, right? And about 99% of us, 98% of us eat gluten. And you've got to have this specific Northern European alleles that make up HLA, DQ2, and DQ8, and about 30 to 40% of us have this. But only 1% get celiac disease. Therefore, these environmental factors appear to be prominent. And this results in celiac disease, which is manifested by the presence of these autoantibodies to tissue transglutaminase and the endomysium, variable pathology plus or minus symptoms, which allow us to call this diagnosis of celiac disease. Now, environmental factors are important, as evidenced by this Swedish epidemic, which in the 80s through into the 90s, there was this epidemic of young children aged less than two with celiac disease. And there it was considered to be due to the introduction of gluten. They'd thickened up the infant formula with gluten and there wasn't much breastfeeding. So they told the women to breastfeed and they took the gluten out and it dropped back down. It's now starting to wander up again, apparently. So this is what led to the consideration that the most important factors were the presence of breastfeeding and the timing of gluten introduction. But there were two very large studies out of Europe in the New England Journal last year that defunct that. So breastfeeding does not appear to be protective, and giving gluten either in the window of opportunity between 4 to 6 months or delaying it till after 12 months doesn't influence whether these high-risk children got celiac disease. Being born by elective cesarean is a risk factor. Getting a GI infection, a rotavirus in children, or Campylobacter in the troops in Iraq or Afghanistan increase the risk. Being born in the summer in the Northern Hemisphere, antibiotic use, the mother taking iron supplements, and PPI use increases the risk. But all of these increase the risk not quite twofold. So we think that maybe any individual has multiple risk factors, some of which are these, but basically we need to work out more what are the other risk factors. And we certainly don't know why celiac disease can come on in an elderly person for the first time or a two-year-old. Now, typically people come to diagnosis by, they go to the doctor, the physician thinks of celiac disease and does blood tests. Certainly the best test, the one with the greater than 90%, 98% sensitivity and specificity is the TTG antibody. We do have these gliadin peptides now that are sensitive and specific, but probably not as good as we thought they were. The endomysial antibody is very specific, but it's costly, it's very observer dependent. The mainstay of testing is the TTG IgA, but its positive predictive value varies with risk of the patient having the disease. It has a very high positive predictive value in high-risk individuals, but only about 35% in the general population. Pathology is certainly the gold standard, and various classifications should be encouraged for the pathologists. And the MASH classification, in which MASH 1 is this lymphocytic duodenitis, and MASH 2, this is accompanied by crypt hyperplasia. It's very hard to diagnose celiac disease with these early lesions, and one would prefer to tell someone they've got celiac disease if they have some kind of villus atrophy, either partial, which is the MASH 3A, subtotal or total villus atrophy. Of all the people, the pathologists are increasingly reporting this MASH 1 lesion or lymphocytic duodenitis, increased intraepithelial lymphocytosis with normal villus architecture. But only about 20% of those individuals actually have celiac disease. Other main causes are considered to be non-steroidals or bacterial overgrowth. The European Society for Pediatric Gastroenterology, Hepatology and Nutrition introduced these guidelines a couple of years ago now, in which they considered that you could diagnose celiac disease in a child without a biopsy. But there had to be pretty strict criteria. The child had to have symptoms, the TTG had to be 10 times the upper level of normal, and then you had to have a second blood draw, because you can see temporary gluten or celiac autoimmunity. You can see it in adults, you can see it in children. So you need a second blood draw. They want the child to have a positive, consistent HLA. And then you could put someone on a gluten-free diet. There's literature raising the possibility that you could do this in adults, but really, I think that it, and this really hasn't taken off in the United States. I don't know about other countries. But it's very hard, I think, to give an adult a diagnosis of celiac disease without a biopsy. The presentations have changed. This is 220 children seen in our celiac centre, and diarrhoea or malabsorption was only the presentation in 10%. The main presentations were recurrent abdominal pain, growth issues, which were failure to thrive or short stature, and screening. And the children that get screened are typically relatives of index cases and certain autoimmune diseases, such as type 1 diabetes and autoimmune thyroid disease. Amongst the adults in a group that we saw, diarrhea was a presentation, but only in 30 to 40%, that diarrhea was the trigger for the evaluation that led to the diagnosis. Incidental recognition at endoscopy, typically for reflux, screening, and once again, the groups that are screened are typically relatives and autoimmune conditions, specifically type 1 diabetes and autoimmune liver disease. There are some with Down syndrome. Metabolic bone disease, anemia, which is usually iron deficiency, but it doesn't have to be. You can have anemia of chronic disease. And this other group has increased, and actually the neurologists are the single greatest referral source after the endocrinologists for our celiac center. Now, how do you get a diagnosis of celiac disease? Because we've been interested in looking at why this underdiagnosis. So certainly the patient has to go to the doctor. And it's interesting that the lowest rate of diagnosis when you put the adults and children together is among young men. From that previous study that I showed, about 1% of men in the United States have celiac disease. But men don't go to the doctor. Women have this compulsory healthcare system called gynecologists, whereas men don't have that. And so men don't go to the doctor. They tend to get diagnosed much later in life. But the patient has to go to the doctor. The case finder has to think about it. And multiple studies show that the case finders are not thinking about it. The endoscopist does biopsies, and not all pathologists are created equal. So there are all these different areas where the people can fall through the cracks. We've been very interested in looking at endoscopist factors. The guidelines state that you need to have 4 to 6 biopsies. And several studies show that you have to have a biopsy of the bulb, 1 or 2. One study suggested that 12 o'clock and 9 o'clock in the bulb were better than the posterior wall or inferiorly. There's this condition that's now being called ultra-short celiac disease, which is celiac disease of the bulb. You know, you can debate, is this real celiac disease? If these people have positive antibodies, they certainly do, but it differs from celiac disease when the distal duodenum is involved. And we recently did a study showing that when you go down, if you take one piece per pass of the forceps, you get a much better set of oriented biopsies, because the pathologist needs to have oriented biopsies. And in this country, we don't put them out on gel or anything like that. They just get shaken into formalin. So, and when these guidelines of taking 4 to 6 biopsies are adhered to, the rate of diagnosis significantly goes up. When we looked at this large database of 130,000 biopsies, the most frequently taken number of samples was 2. That's going down, 1, 2, and then coming out. If you take 4, you diagnose twice the number of cases with celiac disease compared to 2 pieces. So the endoscopist is very important. So I want to now, in the next part of the talk, deal a bit with this non-celiac gluten sensitivity. We call these people PWAGs, people who avoid gluten, or people who avoid wheat and gluten. Typically, it's a self-diagnosis in this country. It's very rare for traditional physicians. It's a self-diagnosis or a non-traditional doctor diagnosis. Analysis of the NHANES data reveals that about the same number of people who actually have celiac disease are on a gluten-free diet. The bulk of those with celiac disease don't know that they got it, and we're not sure why so many people are enjoying a gluten-free diet. There was a study out of Australia that showed that 10% of the population in a random sample from the telephone book are on a gluten-free diet. And interestingly, in this country, blacks were greater than white in adhering to a gluten-free diet. When we look at these PWAGs, we find that there's a high rate of other food avoidance, and typically it's dairy and soy. And we will make an alternate diagnosis in nearly 40% of these patients. I would say that most of them, most PWAGs are not physicians, and certainly most are not gastroenterologists, and yet they're self-diagnosing their condition. And bacterial overgrowth, fructose intolerance is very common. That if you go looking for causes of symptoms, you can often identify it. And then what's very interesting, even though you present that to the patient and offer treatment for it, they rarely want to give up their gluten-free diet. They're very, very much wed to it. And we're seeing a lot of people who have orthorexia. So we've got to be aware of these people with orthorexia nervosa, which is a condition in which people progressively eliminate food types. You know, they find that they're sensitive to gluten, they're sensitive to dairy, they're sensitive to soy, and they're still not better, or for some reason, then sensitive to corn, and they progressively eliminate different food types from their diet, and then they don't really know what to eat. And there's a typical picture of, they're also exercise, it's a variant of anorexia. Now, we didn't really understand what this gluten sensitivity was, and so there are a couple of studies that came out of Australia. And here, Peter Gibson took people who had IBS symptoms and had already self-identified as being gluten sensitive. And they were randomized to receive gluten or placebo. And in this study, they had significantly more pain, bloating, whatever this parameter is, was increased, fatigue was increased, and wind, which we would call gas in this hemisphere, was all significantly increased. So this was like magic. Like at last, someone had shown us that maybe there was something about this gluten sensitivity. So they then did another study with these patients. They put them on a low FODMAP diet and then repeated the study, and there was no difference. So they told us that it did exist, and then they said it didn't exist, right? So what is this gluten sensitivity? At about this time, there was this other study that came out of the Mayo Clinic, led by Michael Camilleri, in which they took people with IBS who had not self-identified as being gluten sensitive, and they noted a decrease in stool frequency with gluten. And this seemed to be limited to the people that had HLA-DQ or DQ8. So that suggested that there is an entity of gluten sensitivity in people with IBS. So it probably does exist, this non-celiac gluten sensitivity, but typically it's a self-diagnosis. The mechanism is not clear. Maybe gluten is inducing some change in permeability, but it might not be gluten. There are 40% of the protein in wheat is not gluten. And we're interested in celiac disease. Actually, half of these proteins incite a very strong immune reaction and some don't. And there are these amylase trypsin inhibitors that have been incriminated as causing change in permeability and induction of intraepithelial lymphocytosis. And maybe the FODMAPs have a role too. And there are now a couple of studies that have taken people who have self-identified as having gluten sensitivity, and then when you challenge them in a double-blind placebo way, only 30% really are gluten sensitive. So it does exist. I don't know when you diagnose it. Maybe you're looking for it in IBS patients, but most of the self-diagnosed gluten sensitive individuals don't have a gluten sensitivity. That was interesting. and in some groups of people, they've really got into this gluten-free diet. So this was a study, once again, out of Australia. They looked at nearly 1,000 international standard athletes in North America, USA, Canada, Australia, and New Zealand, these people came from. And 40% of these non-celiac athletes were on a gluten-free diet 50 to 100% of the time. And it was due to a perceived health benefit and a perceived increase in strength. We all know that Djokovic attributes his tremendous tennis prowess to his gluten sensitivity, and in his recent book, the way he was diagnosed with gluten sensitivity is that a physician held white bread over his abdomen and tested his strength, and it had a definite effect on his strength. So, you know, to win the all these Opens, you don't have to... I won't go there far. Anyway, a gluten-free diet. The other thing is a gluten-free diet is not necessarily a healthy diet. It's low in fiber, B vitamins, and iron. And there's a great concern about heavy metals in rice. One study that recently was in abstract form showed that anyone on a gluten-free diet in the NHANES survey had elevated levels of arsenic, lead, mercury, cadmium, and tin. So it's very important. Whenever we see anyone on a gluten-free diet, we advise them to see a dietitian and be followed by it, because most people on a gluten-free diet eat the same stuff because they know it's safe. And so for the bulk of it, gluten is not the enemy. Now, there's a lot of interest now in the development of therapies for these gluten-related disorders, but we don't have time to talk about that. So thanks very much.